Like a fool, and Rob was saying we need people to present. I said, sure. I want to do Glenn Rodak chairs, and how hard can it be? It can't be that tough. So my wife really loves these things, and I do too. So the Adirondack chair, and I looked it up. It first started in 1903. Somebody up in, it was like in upstate New York or Maine, they wanted to, Thomas Lee wanted to have something he could use outdoors. Very simple design, clean features. One of the big things of trying to do this was trying to figure out what plans to use. It comes in just so many different sizes. There's simple chairs. I found that rustic. Somebody did that. Unusual. I assume that's up from up in Maine, the lobster arms. And then most of us have gone to some tourist place and we've seen the big ones. So, no, I wanted something that was simple, clean, easy to use. So selecting the design was the first problem that I had. Characteristics. I wanted something simple, as I said. Something with clean lines, simple construction, comfortable, and I'm sure I'm going to get arguments on this. Something that's easy to get into, easy to get into and out of. I know people are going to tell me it isn't, but I've sat in these chairs where they put such a steep angle at it, you pretty much need a hoist to get slide back out of it. Mm-hmm. The chair is at a big angle, the arms are at an angle. It's like you were going to take off in a rocket ship. I also wanted something with where the arms were flat, because I want to put my drinks on it. I want to be able to sit here with a nice iced tea and and have a drink. And durable. It's going to be outside. So I wanted something that was weather resistant. I actually spent a long time. I found on the projects, I spent a long time trying to figure out exactly what I want to do, and then I ended up building it, and it actually helps that way. So I got into this, and I had great misconceptions in history. There'll be no market for talking pictures, Thomas Edison. Computers may weigh no more than 1.5 tons. Popular mechanics. 640K of memory should be enough for anybody, Bill Gates. And Adirondack chairs are simple design, so they're easy to build. Me. gray errors. So I had to make my initial decisions. Number one, selecting the wood. I talked to a number of people. They talked about cedar. They talked about cypress. Cypress has had a little bit better, they said. And what I found out is that cypress was like 10 cents more a board foot than cedar, which was kind of surprising. So these are cedar, which is what the pen blinks you have.
Cypress.
Okay, we'll edit that out. I found plans that were very comfortable. Actually, I went up to Woodcraft and sat in a chair a number of times and said, I like this. So I decided that I was going to go with factory-made templates, rather make my own, try and do the plan, do the own. I didn't want to do too much. I was going to go with factory-made templates because they were going to be right and I was going to have it just perfect. This is going to bite me in the, you'll see coming up big time. Probably the worst decision I made on these chairs is go with somebody else's templates. I'm sure that people are going to ask me about this. Each chair cost me about $75 a piece. The wood came out to about $50 a chair. It's about 20 board feet. Hardware was about $15, and the finishing, some oil for protecting, was about $10 a chair. So for those of you who are looking to build these. The first step was creating the pieces. That's pretty simple. One of the hardest problems is the cypress that I got had a lot of knot holes in it, and I didn't want the knot holes there. I wanted strength. I wanted to do it clean. And the plans that I bought best characterized, by the way, this came with the templates, as a 1980s computer manual. Awful. So I tried a new layout and maximize yield. First lesson I learned, I bought these nice templates that said, here's the template for the back slats. You notice the chair, there's something off.
Taller than that.
Yeah, they actually, in the plans, make a note, said, okay, here's the template, make this 25 and 3/8 inches long. So the first thing I did was to cut, because I just did not want to mess up. Lesson two, well, for two chairs, there's 23 pieces per chair. What I realized fairly quickly is I'm laying this out on the wood and I have all these boards out, is, God, it's so easy to make a mistake. So, first off, here's the templates. I'll spread out, they're here if you want to see them. And just as I noted earlier, let me see if I can have this. Somewhere heavy. There it is. Here's the three supplied back slats. And here are the three I made. And for the seat itself, and I call it the front spreader. I'm going to show it to you here. For this, they have different names, front spreader. And for the seat slats, they had no templates. They just said 3.5 by 22, just cut it. So there's actually more pieces than you'll see there. Marked up. This was all over Rob's shop. If you look carefully, what you can see is my pencil lines indicating where I want to cut it. Everything is marked. One of the hardest things is trying to keep count. Did I put enough rear legs? Did I make enough rear legs? Did I make enough of this? So what you'll see on some of these is for here, rear leg, chair one, number two. Somewhere there'll be a rear leg. I probably don't have a picture of it. What's that?
There's also number one.
There's also number one. Somewhere there's a number one. I was trying to see if I had it. Also, by the way, upper rear cross piece, which is where the end of the arms are, no 27 degree cut, because I want to note it has to be cut at an angle. I want to make notes on that. That was a big, big thing to do, just to make sure I had them labeled correctly. Then coming to look, pattern routed, as we just did, as we did with the canes, which turns out not to be so important because the patterns were awful, the templates were awful. Don't trust them. Here's something that was very interesting: the upper, we'll call it the upper rear brace, this part right here. It's supposed to, this supports the back slats, the chairs over there, and try it out later on, by the way, if you want to. Oops, thank you. Does that look any better? The upper rear brace should be symmetrical from right to left. You would think. And here's the pattern for it. I don't know if I fixed this. Yeah, I have fixed this in reality. Well, we stacked them together, and they look just perfect. One of those. So here it is, they're stacked together. What you'll see is, let me find that. Here's piece number one, piece number two, and there is the template right behind it. If you notice, they're pattern routed, it matches perfectly. Until just by happenstance, I'm going to turn one around. Notice? You can see it there. It's about a half inch off.
A half inch.
A half inch. I mean, these were factory made templates. It's a half inch off. We can't see it so much here because that's recessed. And I was sitting there trying to figure out, how do you make that big of an error on a factory made template? Turns out what I was able to do was to just cut off the extra half inch to make them symmetrical and save it. But very disappointing. By the way, not the end of my disappointment with these. We have more lessons coming up. So here they are all cut out, and if you can see, there's a lot of pieces of wood there. Ton of wood. Each one of them, as I said, rear leg, chair 1-2, underneath it will be chair 1-1, chair 2-2, chair 2-1. Every one of those is labeled, and that's the only way I can keep track. Assembly. One of the problems with the assembly, why this chair is so, gets to be challenging, why this chair gets to be challenging is because it's not right angles. You don't have, everything is a 90 degree or something like that. So I tried to see how much of Rob's clamps I could use. I tried to use all of them. I couldn't do it. What you get is prior to putting the arms on, prior to putting the rear upper brace on, those have to be clamped. There's actually, I don't know if I have the right picture for it, but I had attached some right angle pieces so that these would be exactly right angle, the legs would be vertical and everything else, and then you start drilling and mounting. But the nice thing is that once you finally get all that done and you've gotten all those clamps on, you see there's front legs, rear legs, lower back brace, which is right there, front spreader, which is laying right here, then tons of clamps. Once you get all that done, the nice thing is you have a piece that will sit by itself, that will stand, and you can get rid of a whole bunch of those clamps, which was just really tough putting together.
Assuming that face is flat.
This table?
Yeah.
That's Rob's table, and I had a level.
Yeah, it was flat.
There's the level. It was flat.
In my shop, that would be a problem.
That's a fortune box.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
And it was one of the concerns I had, is trying to get this. And that's, by the way, one of the reasons I went to these factory-made, gotta-be-right templates. Because I'm making a right leg, I'm making a left leg. What if I'm off slightly? What if they're not exactly right? Will this thing sit flat? Turns out you can make them sit flat even if the templates are wrong. You do some work. But there it is at that point.
Went out the front leg there. Where it met up to the crossbar, what problem do you have with that?
Yeah, this is another problem I had with the plans. I go to assemble it, and the plans tell me, make this leg flush with this front spreader, which is a great idea. And I see, and the one I saw demoed, it was. Except, and oh, let me turn this so the camera can see it. Let's take a look at the chair right here. If you look at this, the bolts, if I had put this leg further forward, these bolts right here would go right off the end of the leg into the spreader. There'd be no structural support for it. Would not have worked. Immediately made the decision. Oh, and also, by the way, the template, if you follow the nice rules, you use a template which has wonderful guide holes that show you exactly where to put the bolts for the quarter inch, by the way, which are bigger than quarter inch. So if you drill those out, you're really messed up. So we changed the design, and the spreader is proud of the legs. So yeah, it was another lesson learned. Don't trust templates. Yeah, I find, by the way, that when I went through the instructions, it looks like they were written by somebody who's never actually put it together. Nobody put it together according to the instructions and then came back and said, oh, that didn't work. So at this point, there's a basic structure. We have, we're ready to add the arm supports. The arm supports are these little triangular pieces here on the front. See it, bud? Okay, I'll go over here. The arm supports, the arms themselves, and the upper rear back slat support. And there it is with the arms and the arm supports put in. One of the things, by the way, that had to be watched very carefully is this is level. Again, I wanted my iced tea to go real nice up here. So put that in and then added the, you see, added the rear.
So to make sure it's level that pass on the upper, did it have to be adjusted a little bit?
No, I didn't have to do anything because it was cut on the table saw. This is was perfectly 90 degrees. When I assembled the base, this was perfectly vertical. Because
so
I added.
It worked out.
Just yeah, one of the very few things that worked out.
Okay.
When I clamped it, I used the a right angle bracket so that that leg would be exactly vertical, and then
is this anything glued on it or is it all just glued together?
On that chair, there's a lot of glue. Here, there isn't, and that was because we had to take it apart and we're putting it back together today. But where I used quarter-inch bolts, I didn't bother to glue. I figured the quarter-inch bolts, which are the legs and this rear support, my assumption was that's going to hold it very well. But other pieces, such as the front spreader, screwed and glued. And along with this rear and on that other chair, the slats, the back slats.
Would the table or the chair do okay without glue?
I'm going to assume it would. This one's not going to happen, so we'll see what happens. But, I used decking screws. Assumption being, if it's good enough for deck, it's going to hold up for weather on a chair. And they are.
I've done it both ways.
There's some big size screws.
I've done it both ways on porch swings.
Mm-hmm.
And I like glue because on a porch swing, these cleats.
Oh, okay.
I will say that.
Then I might be putting some glue on some of this.
If you talk to us, we had a guy do a presentation one time, and he talked to us all about the properties of the outdoor glue, because he apparently knows a lot about it. So you might.
We have a member who does use glue in this.
Yeah.
Club.
No,
we have any left?
Yeah. This is type 1-3, by the way.
Yeah, that's what he recommends.
Yep. I know, because he handed me the bottle.
No, not that one, that one.
Oh. Okay.
Jerry, raise your hand.
Oh, me?
Yes.
Yeah, we used, it was type 1-3 that I used on this. And again, it was just, who knows if the screws will come loose. I didn't even think about the squeaking, which is probably a
swing.
A swing. Well, swing is going to be much more susceptible to the squeaking.
Well, this is going to carry a lot of weight, so it might start squeaking in the future.
Certainly if I'm on it.
I've built a lot of outdoor furniture, and I've just screwed in and used carriage bolts, and I've never had one come apart.
I don't ever expect this to come apart. I was talking with my wife. We bought a, 28 years ago, we bought a picnic table that was made with pressure-treated wood, and I'm thinking now of taking it apart to replace the nails with screws. Okay. It's just been pretty close to 30 years.
That's yeah, I've had to do that before because some of the stuff I built with galvanized nails, and they'll pop, and the wood warps, and it won't hold it down.
I've found I don't like nails. Again, with this table, you have a bench, and I've had to go and nails out and replaced with screws just so people didn't sit on them the wrong way.
Tony had a question.
No, I was, you was just talking about the glue and everything. It just so happened I had made something in my house that was not intended to be outside, and I had put it together with Pipeline 2, and with all the rain that we've had this week, it did come loose.
Oh, did it?
Yeah, it's true.
The two is water resistant, not waterproof, so yeah. I mean, it was really saturated this week with all the water, but it did not
hold up. And I'm glad I used three.
Yeah.
You
U.S. government actually tests that stuff, and it's PVA 1 and PVA 2. And the tests are totally different because the PVA 2 is the type 1 3, and it's actually immersed in boiling water. And then they test the joint afterwards. And type 1 2 won't pass that test, but type 1 3 will.
Well, my hope had been the screws themselves will hold it, but the glue, when I did it, the glue was just an extra bonus.
The other things that just haven't screwed together, if some piece starts to deteriorate, you can easily take it off and replace it.
I thought of that, and I thought, I'm hoping in Cyprus it's going to hold up. I was actually surprised at how stable this is. Even with this, the arms are very stable. Because when the back slats go in, they're going to provide you with that support for the rear of the arms. Back slat was fairly straightforward. You start with the first one that's going to be centered. The bottom of it is going to be even with the bottom of this rear support. It's just straight. Notice the blocks that I was using, by the way. These were 3/4 inch thick, and we'll get into that in a second. They were just to help clamp it. This started one of the biggest problems I had with this chair, and that is the fact that these screws right here, they, since the back is at an angle, they say 27 degrees, I never measured it, I've got to have a hole that goes straight in here that's going to hit this dead center. It's less than an inch. And trying to figure that out, trying to figure that out was just about impossible. No matter what I did not work. I ended up doing it by eyeball. Not the way that I like to do things, but every time I measured something, it just came off wrong. It did not work right. So that was one of the biggest headaches I had. Notice I've added the other slats to it. Something, and this is just clamped up here so you can see it. Something to take note of, if you look here, they wanted 3/4 inch spacing between the slats. And rather than try and measure anything, the easiest thing to do was just to cut a number of these out of 3/4 inch and just put them in between the slats. It worked out quite well. Something, by the way, and I'm sorry, I did not picture this. I did not have it. One of the jigs I did make for this is for the arm. Set it there so you can see it. The arm has to be placed. They have a specific place with the arm. One of the problems of this is you're putting this arm in pretty much a vacuum. You're hoping you get it right because you don't have the back slats, you don't have the support, you don't have anything, and you're hoping you get everything right. They tell you to make this jig, which clamps up here. Then when you clamp the arm in ready to screw it, it's flush here and flush here. And the last thing which they didn't tell you to do, and I found out to do, is that this side of the arm is straight above the leg. And by taking a piece and just putting it so it was straight above here, then coming to the back and doing the same thing, I knew that I had arms that were straight. They weren't going to go cavy. So that was a big piece because I was doing this prior to putting this board up or drilling or anything else, so it worked out.
You pull a straight line, a straight edge?
Yeah, it was basically just take a straight board and put it here and put it here. And it turned out that worked. I know, I was surprised too. But it worked. Notice that we're putting, I just have this clamped at this point just for the sake of taking the picture. But you'll notice here's the 3/4 inch blocks. They're all level. And I just started installing, then took it all out, but then just started putting them in after the center, working outward. By the way, all this presentation is going fast. This was, as Rob said, about, I have about 80 hours in.
So how did you resolve your angle with the screws in the back?
In some cases, I didn't quite, but it was using a drill with a level on it when I actually drilled the hole. It was trying to get, what I wish I had had was a laser level where I could have set it down, made sure that it was level, and put a light on the backboard to mark the hole. And then I would have been able to drill it. I used a drill with a level built into it so I could get my pilot hole. Not always successful, but.
I'm sure in 1903 they didn't do that.
Yeah. Yeah, but they had a lot more experience than they knew what they were doing.
Yeah, they eyeballed it.
They eyeballed it. Here's something else that I ran into. One, once you get the back slats on, you can do the chair itself. So there is this piece, which is the front lower brace, which you can see is circled right here. Interesting point. By the way, once I went back to the store and told them and used some colorful words for these plans, they gave me this, which is the plans without the template. Notice, by the way, when you get just the plans, you get something nice, colorful, pictures, you can see what's going on, all sorts of stuff. When you buy the more expensive templates, you get this. Did you want to get it? For example, here, there's a layout drawing of how to lay out the wood. There's a drawing here that says, buy this wood and lay it out like this, and it'll all give you the most efficient use. For this, it was, get some wood, and we don't know how much, and go ahead and give it a shot. but I went to put that rear piece on, and if you'll notice, here's the chair that's done. I'm going to bring this forward, but so you can see it. There's a rear piece. There's this rear front piece here and a rear piece, and they go on either side of the back slats. In the nice big plans, they tell you to take a piece of wood, cut this curve, and then they will match. This is actually fixed somewhat. This is what, when I put them together, notice, big hole. They're not the same shape. Again, fixed by lots of sanding to basically reduce this dimension. And I actually cut, for future use, I cut this a little bit. I actually should cut it a little more. If you take a good look at it, you can see it still isn't quite right, but it's closer. I also found at that time, by the way, this, well, I can do it with this one. Oh no.
Put it up on the table.
That's where you want it?
Yeah. This piece right here, I thought, because it says nothing in the plans, I thought that the straight cut was fine because they talk about doing a 27 degree angle cut for this piece back here. Turns out straight isn't right. It has to be at 27 degrees also. They just don't happen to tell you.
The back side of the oval has to be 27.
The back side right here. Good.
Would you have done better when you were recutting it to take a brand new piece and for your template and angle it at 27 degrees and make those two pieces?
It might have been better to take it and do that and throw the pieces that I had away. Here's what we had left after I got everything.
But you're going to make more because you've got all this experience.
I have all this experience, so I'm probably not going to make more. It was a lot of work. My wife is very, very happy right now with these. I had one home yesterday, and I had them home last night, and she sat there and said, okay, you can have it for the meeting, but they come back. So, yes, anybody wants to make these chairs? They're great chairs. I welcome you to come up and try them, try it out. But and here's the templates, and I'll be glad to give you all the advice I can.
That piece you're talking about there, if you cut that out of just one piece, and with an angle, then they fit back right together. If you use one board.
Yes and no. You cut it out, but if you'll notice, and I'm going to angle this for the camera to see it, these two pieces right here, if you can zoom into this closely, they're not at the same angle.
Right.
So this one is tilted forward a little bit. This one is like that. They meet at this angle, so they're not going to be all the same angle on the side cut.
Right, but it don't matter.
You can see, because it's got a V. Yeah.
This piece was pretty much straight up and down because of how the way it was 90 degrees to the back slab. This piece needed a lot of sanding. Something, by the way, about cypress sawdust. I almost swear it could be used as a lubricant, because you pick it up, it's very oily or waxy.
I hate to say this, but from a product liability issue, I mean, is there a way to determine the maximum weight that you'd want to put on something like this? Because it will break eventually if you put enough weight in, I would assume.
Yeah, I'm gonna say it's probably a lot, but no, I don't have anything like that. And I think if I was going to do it again, I might use 5/4 wood instead of 4/4. I might use something a little bit thicker.
Jack, one comment, you'd have to make sure that those angled blades are straight grain.
Here?
No, they're laying here.
This leg
here. Oh, yeah. So that would make a whole and if the grain ran diagonally across there, you might get...
I did not even think about that, to be quite honest, and I probably should have. My thought was, they're pretty thick.
Absolutely.
There's a good bit of wood there.
I guarantee you.
Well, especially if you had a knot, if you happen to be a little careless and had a knot in that side.
This is not 100% knot free, by the way. I just could not find enough wood to make it 100%. What you'll see, there's just a little bit. If you look, I don't know if the camera can show right here.
Bring that back this way.
There's two on the seat.
There's two on the seat, but the seat, they're very light. They're not very deep. There are some, and where I found a knot hole, I filled it with CA and just put in first the thin stuff so it would run and fill all the fibers, then put in the, when I finally had all the fibers filled, I'm going to put this on the floor. When I put all the fibers filled, then I used medium to get and fill it up. Was there a question? So, yeah, this one had a couple on the seat, and quite honest, I like them. I think they add some character to it, as long as they don't take away the structural. If you look, here's one. But it's, you know, some of the knot holes you get, you see they're really deep, there's big voids and everything else. Some aren't. But wherever there was a void, if there was a knot hole that I had to use and a void, I used a good bit of CA to make sure it was strong.
You also put that at the top of the leg rather than the bottom, so that's not
right.
Carry as much weight.
Well, also it's vertical. It's not, you know, on a seat slat or something or this back brace or whatever. I would have been more leery of any kind of knot holes on them. But this was yet another lesson to be learned. Don't trust templates.
You would build this out of white oak, you'd know why it would steal it.
You would be able to pick it up.
Yeah.
Jack, why wouldn't that top tent, when you cut it, if it was wide enough to use for the second tent?
I'm not sure what you're saying.
No, when you cut the top one, this would it drop match the, when it fits?
You say cut them both at the same time.
That's, this tells you cut them to the template. This says cut them at the both side, same time, out of one nice.
That's fine, I'm talking about, make both at one time.
Yeah, that was one of my, oh, I'm so glad that after I cut it according to the great template, I had some instructions that told me do it this way instead.
The revised instructions.
Yeah, I'm convinced that the people who have done this, either one, never actually came back and said, okay, build one according to what we said. Because there's just too many whoops in there.
I guess I'm sure you got a different car, Mom.
Now we're now adding the remaining seat slats, and the assembly was done. Something, by the way, that was interesting, and we're going to add the seat slats and the back slats here. These front slats, and there's a reason I left all three of them on. It's because they make a slight mention of this. After they've given it to you, you find you can't get the drill in to do this. You can't get your screwdriver in. Okay, now drill the holes, the pilot holes for these back slats. Oh, by the way, you might have problems because you can't get your, we found, Rob found something that had, gave me a little bit of a ability to do a little bit of wobble and so forth so we could do it, but it was a nightmare. And because it was so tough, I'm not gonna take them off for the class. They're in, we're gonna leave them in.
Well, you were talking about how long it took you though, but I bet you if you were to do it one more, it would take you a quarter.
It might take me less, not a quarter. It will be done well, because a lot of this, no matter how fast you go, there's 23 pieces per item. It's got to be cut over, it's got to be cut, it's got to be I-template routed, again, great decision to trust them. And then sanded, planed, routed, you know, round over. No matter how you look at it, there were 46 pieces that had to have that done. It's going to take time, and it was an issue. I was told I'd be asked about this. Every time I've seen these, they paint them some nice gaudy color. If I'm going to take the time to make them out of wood, I want to see the wood. So I talked to some, the best advice I had, I hope it's good advice, was this stuff, which is an outdoor oil that's designed for cypress and cedar and stuff, and it has UV protection built in. How's that?
Jack, I've used that on some outdoor furniture. It works pretty well.
Good, because it's also very expensive.
Yes, I know.
That's a $20 can of oil.
I bought two cans.
The good thing about it is, for that chair, which has two coats, I've used about that much of it. So it lasts a long time. It's going to get a third coat, and because we ran out of time, it's not coated well underneath. You have to, the way it's applied is you put it on, you let it sit for about 15 minutes, you wipe it, then come back the next day, because it has to finish soaking. The second coat I put on, when I left, it was all sticky. It felt awful, and I just was so worried.
It does have resin in it, so it has to cure.
The consistency of that is just like working with tung oil.
Yeah.
Put on the same way, it's really tacky, let it set, you dry it out, and it dries pretty quick to you to touch afterward. So they might have something in it that's similar, but it was just like using tung oil on it.
And my biggest concern of that was that, you know, putting it on, when did I do that? I think Thursday I put it on. I wanted to make sure, I wanted it to dry so people could sit on it here.
Yeah.
And it did work. Now, I appreciate, by the way, this is, one of the things I did fail to mention is the plans do not tell you anything about the seat slats. They say just bolt them in place. And I think, Larry, I think you gave me this advice. Put spacers between them. Because when the water hits, you want the water to be able to run out. I just took a narrow piece of wood that we had laying around and used that for my spacer, and it worked beautifully. Again, something they never mentioned in the plans.
Also, isn't there expansion and contraction?
Yeah, if it was very tight, I would worry more about it. If it's, I was really more worried about it, the water drainage at the time.
You should revise those plans.
Yeah, I'm going to have a couple words with the people I bought it from about that. Look, like anything, I want to appreciate the help I've gotten building this, because I would never have been able to do it myself. Also, the standard movie thing, no animals were injured during the making of these chairs. The dogs had a great time. I had, my dog was over there just about every day, and he and Dusty went crazy until he dropped and fell asleep. So, Rob, thank you for all this stuff. We'll make the plans available, make everything available for everybody. Now what for us to do is I'm gonna put the back slats on and the seat slats. I don't know how interested everybody is for that. It's a fairly simple procedure. Again, this does not lend itself well to building it in the class or here, because the assembly was 2 days. Yeah. Thank you.